The opinions and views expressed in the following presentation do not necessarily reflect those of GameCon Radio or its affiliates.
Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We rock your world.
Welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We rock your game. Tonight, we're continuing our special month of Halloween. Is Fright Month for the old Mo Banshee here, and we're going to have, we've got a very cool lineup. Last week, we kicked it off with Paranormal Books and Curiosities out of Asbury Park, New Jersey. And I want to remind everybody that October 21st, October 22nd, and October 23rd will be the Zombie Walk festivities in Asbury Park, New Jersey. Friday, they'll have, something going on with after parties. And then Saturday, they're going to have more stuff. But last year, they did win the Guinness World Book record for having the most zombies appear in one area. And I am very proud to tell you, I had four or five of my zombies were there. So it was a really cool, it's a really fun time. It brings attention to the history of Asbury Park, not zombies, but you know, it's a very historical town, and it's all for good fun. And I hope that a lot more people hear this and get your best war paint on and go out to Asbury Park on the 21st, 22nd, and 23rd. I know that there's a one-day pass, $10 individual, but if you go to New Jersey Zombie Walk, you can get all the information. Everybody knows how I work. I'll do my rant in a minute. Last week, Kathy Kelly was on. This week, it's Matt Moke, zombieresearch.org, and we'll bring him on in a minute. Next week, Psychic Cheryl Lynn is coming on. And then October 18th, the person who runs the Salem Witch Museum in Salem, Massachusetts, is going to come and talk to us all about what went down there in 1692. Then on October 25th, Catherine Ramsdale, The Science of Vampires and the Vampire Trap. She's a forensic scientist, clinical psychology, criminal justice. She's written a slew of books, 40 books, over 1,000 articles about all kinds of things, including vampires. She will be doing our vampires. So all October is Halloween, guys, trick or treat just for you. And Matt is in the wings. November 1st, we're going to switch gears and get back to things that are very important to Mo. Captain Rick Yoakum of New Jersey SPCA is going to come on, and we are going to talk about what people can do to report animal cruelty, or if you suspect there's something going on, that an animal tethered to a tree too much. You know, animals don't have voices that they can speak and say, hello, I'm in trouble. This guy keeps me tethered to this tree and it's three below. Somebody has to speak up for him. So Captain Rick Yoakum is going to come on. He's going to give us good, solid stuff we can use. And I'm working with Dr. Joseph Renzik, who has worked with NASA extensively with the stealth program and other stuff. He's going to be coming on in November. So we've got some heck of a lineup for you guys, and I hope you will enjoy it. Our music tonight are all choices of mats. And one is, I don't know what order they're going to be, but If I Had a Gun, The Dead Milkmen, Something Ain't Right, David Byrne, and Wave of Mutilation, The Pixies. They are Matt's choice, and I listened to them, and they're cool. Some of them were a bit hard to find, but we got them. Okay, Matt Moke, I'm going to share a story with everybody before we start, and I want to thank everybody that's in the chat room. I want to thank everybody listening in who's not in the chat room but listening in. Thank you very much for supporting the show. Some weeks ago, I reported about this chick. It was two women in California. They were walking the one girl's baby. She was in a pram, this baby. This third woman comes out, grabs this baby out of the pram, and starts wailing this baby up against a metal pole. And she was trying to break the baby's arm off to eat it. Now, this started my whole what the heck, and I was reading it out loud, and my son Andrew, which most of you know from me talking about him, he's an ex-Marine, and I'm reading this article out loud, and he's over my shoulder, and he says, a zombie. And I looked up at him with the look of, I don't believe I gave birth to you. And then I looked back at the article, and I said, but Jesus, he's right. This is a zombie. This is a mindless creature eating human people. Then I got to see Deadliest Warrior, which is a favorite of ours. And then anybody who doesn't know what Deadliest Warriors are, they take historic figures like Bat Masterson and put them up against Genghis Khan or something like this. The season finale was zombies versus vampires, for the ultimate battle to see who's actually going to win. And that's, I had been looking for someone to talk about zombies, but keep it a little bit serious, not a joke. And that's when I saw Matt Moke. He was one of the experts. I want to welcome you to my lair, Matt.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Excited to be here. Let me first say, it sounds like you got some great guests coming up, for sure.
God has blessed us. We've had the greatest people on, from Michael Patrick Boatman to Stanton Friedman, Westinghouse scientists. I mean, we had the Ministry of Defense for England on.
Wow.
So when they say, I can't talk about it, we went, okay, thank you. let's move on.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, God has blessed us, and you yourself are a great guest. Thank you. You have a lifelong interest in zombies. You've created the Zombie Research Society in 2007. You're the head researcher. Right. You're also a former, you were trained in the French Foreign Legion.
That's right, yep.
Was that planned to fight zombies? I mean, was that something you said, I'm going to go to the baddest ones I know and get trained?
It wasn't really planned, but looking back, it all kind of fell into place. At first, I got my master's degree in film from New York University, and I concentrated on horror and cinema. I actually did my master's thesis on zombies, and so, that's kind of where it started, coming into all the zombie movies. And then after that, ended up joining the French Foreign Legion, so I was in there for a while and got some survival skills, and then cut back to me back in the United States, and I started working at a disease research facility that studied serious infectious diseases. And so put all those things together, and I started really looking at zombies as if they were a scientific reality, and studying them. How, could this really exist, and what's out there that really, creeps me out, kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. You've got books out. Do you want to give them links so they can find your books?
Yeah, you can actually find them on the website. So if you go to zombieresearch.org, you could find them there. Obviously, they're also on Amazon. So if you just, searched zombies in my last name, M-O-G-K, you'd find them there. So But yeah, the first one is a children's book. It's a cautionary tale that teaches kids how to recognize a zombie outbreak at its earliest stage, and it's called That's Not Your Mommy Anymore. And it's kind of like a Night of the Living Dead meets Dr. Seuss. It's all rhyming, and it's, you know, for little kids who kind of like the dark side of stuff. And then the other one is published by Simon & Schuster, and that's Everything You Ever Want to Know About Zombies. And that's a 300-page nonfiction book that pretty much covers all aspects of zombie science and survival and pop culture. And Max Brooks wrote the foreword on that, and he was the other expert, actually, on Deadliest Warrior, other zombie expert. But he's the author of World War Z and Zombie Survival Guide, and so it's in good company.
I was kind of stunned when I saw him on the show, because, I mean, of course, we think of Carl Reiner, Rob Reiner, they all went into show business where comedy and that, and Max is a funny guy, I can't imagine what it was like working with him, but to know that he's knee deep, and forget it, he's chest deep into zombies kind of floored me. So define what a zombie is.
Well, the definition, you know, the interesting thing about that is that if you look in Oxford's English Dictionary, that the only definition for a zombie there is the voodoo zombie. So they say that a zombie is a soulless slave that's brought back to life by a sorcerer to do its bidding, to work in the fields and to do menial labor. And, you know, if you've ever seen a modern zombie movie, we know that's not what zombies are, according to us, right? I mean, when you think of a zombie, it's a, just like you said, right? A creature that comes out of nowhere and is trying to eat living people. The dictionary doesn't say anything about that.
That's my new one. That's my new thing. Up until I saw that thing about that chick, I never, ever correlated anything but the voodoo deal.
Yeah, exactly.
Because not that.
Yeah, right. But, you know, since 1968, when George Romero made Night of the Living Dead, that's sort of this brand new type of zombie that is relentless. You know, the definition that we use is we call that the modern zombie to differentiate it from the voodoo zombie. So the modern zombie is the zombie you see in Zombieland or, you know, Dawn of the Dead, these type of zombie movies, all the Romero zombie movies. So we say, you know, the modern zombie is a relentlessly aggressive, reanimated human corpse driven by a biological infection. And the reason that, and one of the things that I find so interesting about zombies is that when you really look at them, zombies are different than almost all other popular monsters because they're based in biology and science rather than, you know, you take, for instance, a vampire or a werewolf, and they're based on these ancient myths and superstitions, right? They have this long history and tradition of superstition. They've evolved over hundreds of years. Whereas the modern zombie is really a modern construct. It's only been around for the last 40 years or so. So it's very, very in keeping with our understanding of infectious diseases and disasters and microbiology. So it's really, really different than almost every other popular monster.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the original, it's George Romero, right, who directed... The original one, when it came out, I was down in Atlanta, Georgia. Atlanta Army Depot back then was a real hellhole. And so I was living out in Atlanta, and I went to the drive-in show to watch Willard, you know. And this was the other movie. And right up on the hill from that drive-in was a beautiful cemetery, very similar to the one in the movie. Now, we're sitting here watching this movie, which was a big departure from the old 1940s with the slapstick, and I'm trying to think of the one African-American King of the Zombies, where, you know, move over, boys, I'm a zombie, because they did that black shtick type of thing and all, you know, but we're watching this where the kid gets knocked out on the tombstone, and we're looking up at the cemetery. And mind you, the, most of us there are army or whatever in the area, and we keep looking up to the hill. And I don't think anybody made it through the middle one except me, and I had the doors locked, man. I mean, all I needed was... All we, the people in the car, needed was somebody to bang on the window and say, Barbara, I'm coming to get you. He would have been dead, you know, even as a joke, you know. It was a huge shocker to have that come out, and it gave a lot of people nightmares.
Oh, yeah, and I mean, you're exactly right, and you're not the only one. I mean, when Night of the Living Dead came out in 1968, first of all, Most film scholars credit it as being essentially the first modern horror movie. And what that means is, you know, before Night of the Living Dead, mothers used to take their kids to, like, the Sunday afternoon matinee to go see horror movies. They were just sort of these, you know, mildly scary, often a lot of humor, like you said, and these mildly scary movies that, you know, you could take a little kid to, and they'd sort of be thrilled a little bit, they'd be a little scared, but it wasn't, you know, what we think of as this, you know, gruesome, horrible, you know, that now that you see a, you know, when you see a horror movie now, you know, even Texas Chainsaw Massacre or the Saw series that have come out recently, you know, you'd never take a little kid to any of those. And Night of the Living Dead was really the first movie that came out that was like that. So it really redefined horror. And it created, you know, the modern horror genre. It also created, you know, the modern zombie, which is great. But, you know, the reaction, when you look at, what I love to look at is the quotes from other famous filmmakers and what they thought of Night of the Living Dead. For instance, Stephen King was a sophomore in college when he first saw it, and he said, quote, it turned him to jelly. He was so freaked out by it. And granted, you know, you got to remember, at this point, Stephen King hadn't even decided what he wanted to do with his life. He hadn't even picked a major yet, right? Wes Craven, you know, the famed horror film director Wes Craven, he was living in New York City. He had never seen a horror movie in his life, and he had no interest in seeing a horror movie. It was not a genre that he was interested in. And a friend dragged him to it, and he said it had changed his entire life. And he's gone on to you know, direct some of the most iconic horror movies ever made. So when you look at, you know, I got another great example. Quentin Tarantino says that George Romero, through Night of the Living Dead, is single-handedly responsible for all the action and gore and blood and guts that we love in those kind of genre movies. So, you know, people that really love movies and have seen all these movies, I mean, they it's sort of across the board, they credit George Romero with really starting something brand new. Let me give you one more example, which I really love, is Boris Karloff, you know, who's famous for doing all the old movie monsters, right? The same year that Night of the Living Dead came out, when he saw it, he said, my kind of horror isn't horror anymore. I mean, that's a quote, and you know, that's exactly right. You know, it's gone are these slow-moving horror dramas, you know, with a little mystery and a little romance. Now we're talking about really in-your-face, you know, watching people get eaten and really over the top stuff, you know, that, well, like you said, go ahead.
I don't care what Boris Karloff movie made. You at some point felt some sympathy for Frankenstein. I mean, this poor dead guy, you know, that was raised up and thrown into this nightmare and, you know, basically has the IQ of a slug when he starts out. You always felt sorry for him. But in zombies like this, and even the old zombie movies, these were victims who were always brought back to be caught by some bad person. You never actually looked at the zombie and said, oh, they're horrible, terrible things. Oh, my God. You always felt sorry for them because somebody was manipulating them. Now, these zombies are apex predators, baby, and they're not there to make love to you. They're just there to eat you.
Yep, exactly. I mean, and that's when you talk about it in terms of the difference between a zombie and a vampire, right? That's really a big difference, right? A vampire is a lot more human in a lot of ways. For instance, a vampire is smart enough to know that if it's living in a certain area, it's not just going to eat all the humans in that area because then it'll starve to death. Whereas zombies don't care. Zombies will eat everything and they don't care, you know, if they destroy the entire planet. They're fine with that. Whereas vampires traditionally have always kind of tried to live in society and, so you know, live in the shadows kind of thing. Man, if you see one zombie, you know, then you see 10,000, and then you see 10 million, and then it's the end of the world. I mean, that's kind of how it works, so...
Yeah, something Max Brooks said, you know, when you're fighting a zombie, don't bring a gun or a rifle because, you know, you're announcing the dinner. You're ringing a dinner bell. You know, they hear the sound and they go to it, you know. Vampires are about stealth and staying in the backgrounds. And as you say, not depleting the food supply. Zombies don't go that far into it to even understand there's an end to the food supply, you know, that doesn't even, there's no rationality into it. So you can't look at them and say, hey, if you kill me, there won't be any more. You know, that's not going to work with these guys.
Exactly. Yep.
Okay. Yep. So let's talk about how one becomes a zombie. I was thinking about this whole thing today. And I do want to get into the history of outbreaks because it's kind of like, what is that? The movie with Tom Hanks, Da Vinci Code, where you're kind of linking a lot of things that have no explanations to outbreaks through history. But the Universal Soldier with the, right. You know, Jean-Claude Van Damme and the other
right.
kid. In some respects, the scientists take dead guys and turn them into servants or slave zombies. Is that not similar to a possibility?
Well, it sort of could be, but if you think about it again, and it's a subtle distinction, but the biggest difference between that traditional voodoo zombie that, like you said, you could maybe use as a slave, as a warrior slave or something like that, And the modern zombie that we see in most movies and popular culture today is that you cannot, you know, it is relentlessly aggressive. You can't reason with a modern zombie. You can't direct it in a certain way. So that zombie will try to, if you want to be the master of a zombie, the zombie will try to eat who you want it to eat, but it'll also try to eat you, and it'll try to eat everybody in between. So there's no rationalizing with the zombie. There's no, you know, convincing it to do what you want it to do. And that it really is. And I think this is something maybe Max said in the show also, but it really is sort of like a walking virus. So if you think about zombies as impersonal as a virus, so it really is just a sickness that is in human body form. And so this sickness is literally just trying to spread itself all over, you know, as an infectious disease. So you say, you know, how do you become a zombie? I mean, you really become a zombie the way that you catch any other disease. You are exposed to that disease in the right way. So with a zombie, we think about the zombie sickness as being a blood-borne illness. So that means if the zombie bites you or gets any fluid contact in you, so if you get a drop of zombie blood in your eye or something like that, then you are then doomed to become a zombie. So it mirrors a lot of other infectious diseases. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Where you lose control. You see, the more I delved into it, the more I'm thinking there are classifications. Maybe maybe my idea seems a little bit ridiculous because you've been doing this your whole life, but you've got the blood-borne or blood-transmitted zombie. You know, some moron in some government facility someplace is trying to figure out how he can turn a dead person into the perfect soldier and control them. Now, this is not a nice way to correlate it, but AIDS, HIV,
yeah.
AIDS, that's
totally
exactly how it came to be. The governments were looking for a environmental way, a virus of sorts to use, and the people being exposed to it didn't show any symptoms, so they thought it was a failure, turned them loose, And that's what happened. It spread before they realized what the heck had happened. They unleashed it. So there's that whole thing, like, where the government's doing it. But then I look at this chick that tried to steal the baby to eat it. Now, yeah, she's a drug addict, obviously. She was on crack. But here's something else that's mindless. And drugs are defining the day, and she actually was hungry, so she attempted to eat a baby. And I think there was another case in another country not long ago where the same thing. I mean, if you live in a town where small animals start to disappear, you know, I'd start looking for some kind of a zombie, something that would be kind of like a zombie, right?
Yeah, I actually got a couple thoughts on that. One is there was a, it was not last summer, but the summer before, there was a very similar case in New Orleans where a 65-year-old man was mowing his lawn, and another man came up to him and walked up slowly to him, didn't, you know, run, and didn't seem aggressive, walked up to him. The old man asked him if he needed any help, and the other man bit him in the arm, took a big chunk out of his arm and ate it, and then ran away.
See?
So yeah, you know, there are definitely all sorts of weird examples like that. But, you know, speaking of, you are trying to create a soldier, or, you know, trying to create zombies in the lab, I actually interviewed a virologist from the University of Miami, and she's not into zombies. And I just sort of, you know, there's this new wave of living zombies. So I don't know if you've seen 28 Days Later or even Zombieland, which is the, you know,
Zombieland. This is awesome. My son introduced me to Zombieland, and actually that's pretty funny.
Yeah, well, you know, the cool thing about Zombieland, or interesting thing, is those zombies actually aren't dead. They don't rise from the dead. They just get sick with something, and they're still technically alive. And if you notice in the movie, they never show anyone die and come back to life as a zombie, right? They just show someone change into a zombie. And then there's also not the focus on shooting them in the head. With every undead zombie movie, it's always, oh my gosh, we got to shoot them in the head. It's the only way to kill them. But in Zombieland, they never did that. And I actually for my book, Everything You Ever Want to Know About Zombies, I interviewed the writers of Zombieland. I said, hey, you know, it seems like the zombies in your movie aren't actually dead. And they said, yeah, that's exactly right. It's a new, you know, it's this new kind of zombie. It's a living zombie. Looks just like a zombie. Acts just like a zombie. But they still need to drink water. You can still kill them by stopping their heart. You know, they're still technically alive. And if you think about zombies in that light, this virologist at the University of Miami, when I told her the symptoms, said, you know, we could create a zombie sickness in the lab today, no problem. She said, it's a lot more complicated to clone people or clone sheep, which we have the technology to do, than it is to combine one or two or three serious deadly viruses. For instance, combine a deadly form of rabies with a deadly form of the flu, and mix in a couple other viruses in there to help it spread more quickly, and all of a sudden you've created this airborne zombie sickness that turns everyone into raving lunatics that attack and bite each other. And
yeah,
that is exactly
that.
The premise of 28 Days Later, you know, except it's even worse because it's airborne.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what's that new one, too, on AMC, Dawn of the Dead?
Yeah, The Walking Dead.
Walking Dead, yeah, that's the same thing. We're going to have to go to break in 2 minutes. So we do have a question, which I'll give you a heads up on. Anthony in England is asking, Spooky UK in England is asking, is there anything they're afraid of? But we'll let you answer as soon as we come back. And first song we're going to play, Something Ain't Right by David Byrne. That'll be during the break after the commercials. And hang in there, guys. Just hang in with me. Anthony is running a contest for Asylum and the show and all. October and November contest. What it is there's a book, The Mammoth Book of Cover-Ups, The 100 Most Disturbing Conspiracies of All Time. Now, to get your name in the drawing, what you have to do is, during the show at some time, I'm going to give you a heads up and say, the word is. And what you do is you write that down, and then you jump on asylumsgate.com, free registry, and you text message Anthony there, Spooky UK, with the word, and your name will go in a drawing. Now, the way I understand this is going to work is it's going to be through October and November, and then he will have his wife or one of the kiddies pull the name out, and that's how that's going to work. So I'm going to make it real easy on everybody because we've got a really fast show tonight, and I've got a lot of ground to cover. The word you need is da-da-da-da. Wayne Weird, W-A-N-W-E-I-R-D. Next week isn't going to be so easy, guys, so write it down and get a hold of Anthony on Asylum's Gate and send it in. We're going to be right back, and we're going to talk about, is there anything that zombies are afraid of or you can use to control them? This is GameCon Radio. We are rocking your game. We are rocking your night tonight with Matt Moke. And he's from the Zombie Research Organization.
Station your mother warned you about.
Just a reminder, guys, all our talk show hosts here at GameCon Radio volunteer their time, but you can always show your appreciation. Click on the tip jar and give them a little love. I'm sure maybe your predictions will come out a little bit better. And that's how we roll here at GameCon Radio. We rock your game and your paranormal.
Back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. GameCon Radio is a wonderful internet radio show all over the world. We've got great DJs, great music all the time. You can tune in, just do whatever you're doing and listen to the music, listen to the shows. Let's see this. Schedule. Let me just bring up the schedule because now Smoochie and Homeroom is before me on Tuesdays, and I'm trying to bring it up, but we have a show before Danger Zone with Disenchanted. She's got an afternoon one, and then Smoochie at 8 o'clock with Homeroom, and you're gonna love that. Lots of music, lots of cool stuff to listen to, and then Mo Banshee's Lair. On Saturdays, we have Shadowlands with Dr. William Lester, old time radio stuff. You've got shows on the schedule page. Trust me, you're really gonna love this stuff when you start listening to it, and the music is awesome too. Okay, so we're going to bring back Matt and talk about, and welcome Shadow. Shadow Brian is here with us. And hello. Yeah, he's up here, and the whole family is here, the whole flam family. Anthony was asking, well, actually, first we're going to go to the book signings. You have book signings and lectures coming up, Matt. Tell us about them.
Oh, yeah, I've got, you know, October's a busy month, so I've got a bunch of book signings going on, and I got one in New York City. It's at the NYU bookstore down by Washington Square Park. That's this Thursday at 6 o'clock, and then I've got I'm going to be in Detroit, I'm going to be in Chicago, and then I'm going to be kind of all over the country at colleges giving lectures, zombie lectures. I think I got six or seven of them this month, and you can find out all the information on all of them, on all the stuff that I'm doing at mattmoke.com. So just M-A-T-T-M-O-G-K. .com, and or if you, even if you just, you know, Google me, you'll probably find it that way too. But it's got my whole schedule there, so you can see. I know I'm going to be in Virginia, I'm going to be in Alabama and New Mexico and all over the place, Arizona. So.
Okay, and of course, Zombie Research Society. You can always get a hold of them there, and it's really funny because I emailed you during the show Deadliest Warriors, and you know it didn't even click with me that this the panel was live. You know, we're so used to watching things that are pre-recorded and everything, and I emailed Matt and said, geez, would you like to come on the show? He says, sure. You know, he says, but I'm in the studio right now. And I was like, he's in the studio right now. And my son said, yeah, look, Mom, he's on the TV. And I went, oh. So thank you very much for getting back to me so fast. Wow, that was it was incredible. Anthony,
Modern technology, right?
I'm telling you, it is crazy. And that's why I the more I've been looking at this, the more I don't think the concept of a zombie, a creature that's mindless, that is just a, as I called it before, apex predator that does nothing but eat. It's not even like a shark. Sharks at least stop long enough to make baby sharks. These things are not going to do that. You know, they're not stopping to have sex. They're not a vampire. They're, you know, with bad breath and really funky clothes and sleeping in a coffin with worms and dirt. These things just constantly move looking for food, you know. So Anthony is asking, is there anything they're afraid of? You know, clown suits, is there anything, you know, Frankenstein, yeah, he held up a torch and he ran, you know, these guys?
Right, yeah, it's a really good question. And first let me say that in terms of my research and Zombie Research Society, we try really hard not to make anything up. So what we say, so for instance, we don't say there was a zombie outbreak last week at a Walmart in Iowa or something like that, because we all kind of know that didn't happen, right? But so we say we'll never actually know specifically what the zombie outbreak will be like until a zombie actually shows up at your front door. But what we do is we develop theories about how they probably will function, and then we you know, test those theories, and we try to come up with better ideas so that we have a better chance of surviving when it actually happens. So with that said, I will say, you know, all prevailing theories are that zombies don't fear anything, or at least don't show any fear. So, for instance, if a zombie's coming at me and I hit it in the head with a baseball bat, it won't try to duck, right? It doesn't try to get out of the way of the bat. It doesn't try to avoid any potential harm to itself. And so the question is, well, why doesn't it do that? You know, because you would think if you had the fear reflex, potentially, you know, that's for sure where you would display it, right? I mean, you would try to shy away if someone's, you know, cutting off your leg or something. But zombies don't. They just keep coming and coming. Now, there's a really interesting study out of Italy where they just found essentially what they call a fear switch in the brain of humans. And they can actually turn this switch on and off. And what this switch is, when it's in the on position, the person will react appropriately to fear. So if you try to hit or hurt the person, or if the person becomes afraid of something, they will react, they will shy away from it. They'll try to run away, they'll try to get away from it, they'll try to protect themselves. But if you turn this switch off in the human brain, the exact opposite response happens. That human that's being scared or trying to be hurt will actually become more violent and more aggressive. So potentially in zombies, maybe they do fear, but the thing is, as we attack them more and more, as they become in greater harm, they actually get more aggressive. They aren't able to shy away. It's actually hardwired into their brain that they can't shy away from things they're afraid of. They actually have to chase after those things even more and try to attack them even harder. So that's, I think, kind of an interesting theory out there. But mostly, I would say the simple answer is no. from everything that, you know, I've researched and seen, pretty much zombies aren't afraid of everything. Now, I should say, in Night of the Living Dead, which you already mentioned, in 1968, zombies were clearly afraid of fire in that movie. And one of the ways that the people in the movie kept the zombies from coming in the house is they lit a chair on fire and they put it in the front yard. And the zombies sort of stayed away from fire. So, now, that has sort of evolved over the years in our in our popular culture understanding of it to be that zombies really aren't even afraid of fire. I mean, you could set a zombie on fire and it still doesn't care. It'll still come running after you. So, you know, potentially they could be afraid of something. I wouldn't like to test it. I mean, I would like to. If you find yourself in a zombie outbreak, I would say the smartest thing to do is to assume that they're not afraid of anything. Because if you decide that you think they're afraid of clown suits and you're wrong, you're going to be one dead guy wearing a clown suit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the concept pretty much is that, you know, what is the movie, Jurassic Park, where the guy's got the electric prod and the little whatever they are is coming, and they're not afraid of anything, and then he zaps one and they all run, and he says, well, now they are. You know, the difference with zombies are they're not capable of retaining that memory that something is harmful to them. So, and basically they're just like a one cell amoeba, you know, just eat. That's all. And so, I mean, there's a lot of things up for debate on it. And your site definitely says that it should be hotly debated before it's in our backyard. Ghost in the chat is asking a question. And before I lose it, how can you predict a situation from a theoretical creature? And he says it's odd when the notions about zombies, we have a shortage of them. And that's basically, up until I read about that girl that attacked the baby, I would have agreed we have a shortage of it. But actually, I'm not disagreeing with you, but I am of the opinion we already have a zombie outbreak, but it's the kind where drugs have produced mindless creatures out of people. You know, when I was a kid, and I'm going back to the Stone Age, okay, here, you know, they would tell you, don't do drugs. It will make you, and they would show you pictures of people that's just stared like, you know, Frankenstein, yeah, catatonic, and that kind of thing. It makes you mindless. It destroys your mind and all. But I'm seeing it more and more. The problem is these people, while they may not be able to understand, grabbing a baby and trying to eat it is wrong, they still have that aggression factor. They can't control aggressiveness, violence. All of these things are intact and in full swing. So, you know, I think we do have zombies to start studying, albeit chemically created zombies, but we do actually have something to start pointing the way and start researching. What was the next thing? Which brings us to the Anthony's question. You said that there's nothing really they're afraid of. Viruses, okay. Rabies and mad cow. That seems to be the two things that are fearsome, huh?
Yeah, mad cow is really actually disturbing, probably even more so than rabies, because mad cow in humans is called Creutzfeldt-Jakob's disease, and so it's essentially, you know, all it is mad cow on people, but it's created by a protein, so it's actually not a virus. It's just a normal protein that has become mutated, so it's this mutated protein that's been around since the beginning of time. So this protein has always been around, but if you notice, we've really only heard about mad cow a lot in the last 10 years or so, 10, 12 years, right? We didn't, you know, when I grew up, I'd never heard of mad cow. We never sort of heard, you know, it wasn't really around at all. So what's happening with this protein is that the symptoms that it manifests in people are changing in disturbing ways. and it's becoming more easily transmitted from person to person. So actually, it's 100% fatal and 100% communicable, meaning if you're exposed to it, you will get it and you will die for sure, 100%. So that sort of rings like a zombie. And then secondly, the new symptoms are that it causes you in its late stages to go insane, and often it causes you to go violently insane. And on top of that, there are new indications that it's transmitted from blood to blood. Meaning if I get it and I go violently insane and I turn around and attack you and bite you, you will then for sure get it and you will go violently insane and attack another person. And that is exactly the premise of Zombieland, literally, word for word, the premise. And this isn't science fiction. I mean, this information is all gotten from reputable science institutes, the Scripps Institute, the Mad Cow Institute in England. So the prion diseases, here's the worst thing about it. Prions, these proteins, are technically dead. They're not alive. So it's not like a virus that has this nucleus that's driving it, right? It's not like a bacteria. It's technically dead. And they couldn't figure out why the symptoms were changing, because why would these symptoms be changing over the past 10 years? And they just recently discovered about 6-7 months ago that the protein itself is evolving. So the structure of the protein itself is evolving. And the problem with that is that everything we know about evolution, dead things can't evolve, right? It makes as much sense with our understanding of medical science to say a pencil is evolving and growing wings, or my car out in the parking lot is evolving and I'll come out and it'll have a fifth tire on it. But it doesn't make any sense that this protein is evolving. So if you ask any scientist, literally this is the thing in the world, the pathogen in the world that we know the least about. We just don't know why it's doing what it's doing. But what we do know is it continues to evolve and it's doing things that are more and more disturbing. So any expert I talk to who's not into zombies, you know, any medical expert I talk to, whenever I start talking about zombies, they always bring up prion diseases, these brain diseases that eat your brain and make you go crazy, because they say, you know, that is really where they think serious, you know, what if the thing just takes a big jump in evolution and all of a sudden literally creates a zombie? I mean, there's no reason why that couldn't happen.
What about Alzheimer's? That's also a protein that creates plaques on the brain.
Yeah, that's interesting. The strange thing about prion diseases is that what it does is when this mutated protein gets in your brain, mm-hmm. it doesn't spread like you think a virus, like HIV. We'll take HIV. If you get HIV, HIV goes into your cells and it creates more of itself. It replicates itself. The mm-hmm. prion diseases, they don't replicate themselves because they're dead. They can't replicate themselves. So what they do is somehow, and we don't know how, they mutate all the other proteins in your brain. So actually they turn your own brain against you. They make every other protein in your brain a similar mutated protein. And until you have no more normal proteins in your brain, and that's when you go violently insane. So when we think about, you know, the brain drives the body in a zombie normally, and we have these raving lunatics who can't think and have lost all their personality and don't have, you know, many abilities and don't have memories, that really starts to look like some sort of hybrid prion disease or prion disease. It's freaky. Yeah, it freaks me out.
Yeah, because in my Health News Daily today, they said our findings open the possibility some of the sporadic Alzheimer's cases may arise from the infectious process, similar to the way mad cow disease. And violence in an Alzheimer's patient is not unheard of. I mean, because mm-hmm. We have one in the family, and that is a big dangerous part of it is that lashing out part. Mad cow disease, we're being asked in the chat, that was started when cows were fed cows infected with it, right?
Exactly, yeah. And that's the crazy thing, is that you used to only be, first of all, mad cow, it used to be really difficult to transmit mad cow from one cow to another, and it also used to be nearly impossible for a human to get mad cow disease from a cow. Essentially, what you had to do is you had to eat the brain. You literally had to eat the part of the body that was infected with these mutated proteins. So what mm-hmm. happened was, they took these down cows and they ground them up and they fed them to other cows. And some of those some of those cows were infected with mad cow disease. And again, mad cow disease has been around forever. So, but they did this, and they caused it to be more infectious. But the problem is that now it's evolving, like I said, and so now you don't even need to eat the brain. In fact, there's a researcher in Sweden, and this is probably 2 months old at the latest. A researcher in the Sweden, the National Science Foundation just reported, has discovered a strain of mad cow that infects mice that is aerosol, that's airborne. That means not only do you not have to eat the brain, and not only do you not have to be bitten or attacked by someone who's infected, all you have to do is be in the same area as that person, because their infection is airborne. So literally, as they're breathing in the air, they're breathing out these mutated proteins, and if you breathe them in, you will get it and you will die. Now, I mean, we got serious problems. When I first read that, I told the head of the National Public Health Preparedness Initiative at the University of Pittsburgh. It's a government-funded think tank to get ready for public health disasters, major public. And I told him, hey, have you seen this study where the Swedish doctor has found this airborne prion disease? He said, oh, God, tell me that's not so. Because literally, if something like that got out, I mean, we really are talking the end of the world. When a really deadly strain of the flu, will, like a super deadly strain of the flu, will kill like 1 or 2% of the population, right? It doesn't kill very many people. And a lot of people that get infected don't die. The problem with the prion disease is everyone who gets infected dies, every single person. It's the only sickness like that. So if you are exposed to it, you will die for sure.
Excuse me, rabies, from the time of the bite, it can take 10 days for the symptoms to show up. But then they only have about 7 days after that. So from the time they're bitten to death is like something like 17 days if they're not treated. The first 10 days, they really aren't aware of what's making them sick. And by then, it's probably not going to be something that can be handled, you know?
You're totally right. Once you start showing signs of rabies, you are also going to die for sure. But the big difference in rabies is that if I get bitten by a dog, I can go in and get rabies shots, because you do have that window of time before the rabies actually gets to your brain. Whereas a prion disease, it doesn't matter. You are dead. You could be totally healthy, and you could say, well, I feel fine. What's the problem? And if you have been exposed to it, you are a goner no matter what you do.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's the idea of the little girl in the Night of the Living Dead. The car is toppled
over. Totally.
One of those things bit her, and she kind of went into a coma, and she just died, you know. But, of course, it's like a 24-hour thing, the movie, and they made it fast. But the reality is, you may not know you're infected or not put two and two together and you're dead. And if it is going to be an airborne thing, we're looking at bioterrorism here. I mean, this is scary stuff here. I mean, it's just terrible. We're going to go to break in about 3 minutes, and the next song that Matt picked was the Pixies, Wave of Mutilation, and that's what we'll be playing. Again, give them the link to your site. It's zombieresearch.org, and the other is mattmoke.com, right?
Yep.
And the names of the books are, again?
Everything You Ever Wanted to Know About Zombies. That's the big nonfiction book. It really covers, I mean, I'm not kidding, it's got pretty much absolutely everything. The other one is the Zombie Children's book, and that's called That's Not Your Mommy Anymore.
Yeah, I really want to talk about that one. that sounds scary. Are we talking about, like, somebody hooked on drugs that's completely out of their mind, not your mommy, or what?
No, we're literally talking about a mom that gets bitten and turns into a zombie and tries to chase her kid around the house and eat him.
Oh,
the old school Romero zombie. And you know, I tip my hat to a lot of old zombie movies and that. So Romero's actually even in the book, like a cartoon image of Romero. And it's all in good fun. It's all rhyming. It's sort of like, you know, that's not your mommy in the hall, that's not your mommy at the mall, that kind of stuff, you know?
When we come back, Deadeye had a question, and was, what are there any documented zombie attacks? And when we come back from the break, we're going to talk about that, which works really well into this. Outbreaks, you have seven of them listed, historical situations where large populations disappeared or whatever, and we want to talk about that when we come back. And are there now documented cases around that are, I guess, contemporary, the last 100 years or 200 years. This is GameCon Radio. Our guest is Matt Moke, and we are talking about a zombie, what is it called? Infestation that could happen? I don't know. But you got to be ready for it, because as far as I'm concerned, I think we already have zombies running around. And it's getting scary out there. So we'll be right back. This is GameCon Radio, rocking your world.
Hip, quit that. Here at GameCon Radio, we never test our music on animals.
Bishop Long and the American Institute of Metaphysics is proud to announce their class on demonology. Students will receive a very detailed class on demonology, and the class will be presented by Bishop James Long, who is the exorcist and presiding archbishop for the United States Old Catholic Church. Enroll today. Visit www.instituteofmetaphysics.com or call 1-877-623-3241.
Welcome back to Mo Benchy's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We're rocking your world tonight with Matt Moke, who is the founder of the Zombie Research. I think I hear a mic open or something because I hear a hissing. But we're just talking during the break about transmitting this disease. And I remember back in the 70s, the great concern was mosquitoes biting somebody infected with AIDS and maybe transmitting it. And Matt made a very good point that if you're infected with this stuff, but you're not falling down from it yet, you may not be aware you're even affected with it, especially if it becomes airborne. And now a mosquito bites you, or one of those we have in New Jersey, those horse flies, you know, those ones that carry away your young, you know, and you know, the ones I'm talking about, you know,
they come.
You keep an M16 or an M1 in your closet just to kill the flies, you know.
And tennis racket will get rid of them pretty good.
Yeah, you know, they're nasty, but you know, they live on blood. You know, so if they bite somebody infected with this stuff, it's going to spread because they're going to bite somebody else, because that's the way those little buggers are. Michael asked, are there any documented cases of zombies? And on your site, you have seven historical situations, hang on, that evidently you attribute to a zombie outbreak.
They are. I mean, the way that we say it is they're potential, you know, zombie outbreaks. They're sort of. I'll give you a perfect example of one of them. I'll just give you one of seven of them. But I don't know if you're familiar with the Lost Colony of Roanoke, right? Lost Colony of Roanoke was intended to be the first permanent British settlement in the United States in the late 1500s. And 110 colonists landed on Roanoke Island and off of the coast of North Carolina. And the supply ship left, and it came back 2 years later, and no one was there. Now, all men, women, and children, everybody was gone. There's still no accepted explanation for what happened to these colonists. It's the largest mystery in early American history. So the thing is that, you know, there wasn't any war. There weren't hostile Native Americans around there. They didn't starve to death because they still had food there. Their camps were still there. There's still evidence of, like, that they were there, that they had been there. Nothing was burned down. It's not like it was all devastated. It's just the people were all totally missing. And so that in and of itself, you go, well, it's an interesting mystery. But 2 years ago, an archaeologist from Harvard, I believe his name's William Steiger, he found evidence of mass cannibalism on Roanoke. So what would cause these colonists from England to all eat each other when they weren't starving to death and the Native Americans around there weren't cannibals? Nobody was, you know, there's no cannibal tradition in the United States. And what would cause all these people to eat each other? So the suggestion is potentially that could have been the site of some sort of historic zombie outbreak where they encountered a zombie sickness, unleashed it somehow, and they all turned into zombies and ate each other, and then they either wandered off into the ocean when everybody was dead because it's a small island, or they wandered around the island until they gradually disintegrated back into the earth. Because zombies, you know, they are walking corpses, so they're rotting. So in theory, they're not going to live forever. So that's definitely one that I think is interesting. Now, again, that remains a mystery. So I'm not saying that that was absolutely a zombie outbreak. What I'm saying is that with this new evidence of this mass cannibalism that has absolutely no explanation by any expert, it does open some very interesting questions.
Well, you do have two that are a little bit similar and might, I guess you could kind of put them into it, the Donner Reed Party. The people got stuck up, let's see, 1846, they were snowbound in the Sierra Nevada, and they had to resort to eating the dead to stay alive, okay? And then the Uruguayan Air Flight 571 that crashed in the Andes, and the soccer rugby team ended up eating their dead to try to survive. So a lot of people equate that to cannibalism.
These guys were all
alive.
That's absolutely cannibalism. I mean, I wouldn't say that that's zombies. But I would say, though, how that relates to zombies is that when we experience a catastrophic zombie outbreak, people are going to have to be making very, very difficult choices about what they're going to be eating. And I'm not talking about the zombies. I'm just talking about the people here. Because all companies and most governments pretty much operate on a just-in-time management principle. And what that means is that goods and services are delivered on an as-needed basis. So a grocery store, for instance, doesn't need a big storage warehouse, because if you go to the grocery store and you buy a can of tomatoes on Tuesday, on Thursday the truck will show up and it will deliver one more can of tomatoes because it knows that store sold a can of tomatoes because it's all computerized. Now, if that supply chain breaks down for any reason, and I would have to say that a catastrophic zombie outbreak would be a pretty compelling reason not to show up for work to make your delivery, right? Mm-hmm. If that breaks down for any reason, our store shelves are going to be empty immediately, and people are going to be having to make very drastic choices very quickly on what they're going to eat. So I think that the Donner Party and the rugby team, they relate a lot more to the really horrible choices that humans are going to have to be making when we're faced with a catastrophic zombie outbreak. I think that there's real evidence that the largest threat in a zombie outbreak will be other people, not zombies. I think that the most danger you will face is at the hands of other desperate people. And I'm not talking about roaming thugs that are taking advantage of the situation and just want to do harm. I'm talking, unfortunately, about your neighbor and friend. There was a Chilean earthquake in 2010 that hit off the coast of Chile, and it was a big deal at the time. And NBC Nightly News did a report back then that said basically a nightmare scenario was playing out of neighbor looting neighbor. So it was 3 or 4 days later, and people were out of water. They had no water. They had no food. And neighbors used to play on the same soccer team together, they were literally taking their guns and going over to the neighbor's house and saying, sorry, buddy, but I need to take your food because I need to keep my kid alive. So that's the kind of stuff that you really need to be thinking about, I think.
Yeah, there was a restaurant a couple of weeks ago. The police were alerted by the silent alarm, and they found a homeless man in there, and he wasn't after the money. He was cooking dinner for himself, you know. Wow. There's a lot of these stories now where restaurants and stores are being broke into, but not for the money they might be having. People are taking meat. Food, you know, and this goes back to something I said early on in the show that, if you notice cats and dogs missing in your block, you know, start, you know, paying attention to what's going on, because as this, and they keep calling it a recession, but I hate to make everybody even more afraid, but we are definitely in the beginning death throes of a depression. And as people are struggling to find a way to feed their families, you're going to see a lot more of this. You're going to see them willing to rob their neighbors for food and willing to eat a cat. You know, there's a bunch of wild cats in the town, so they start hunting them down and eating them because they're food, you know. But then again, you're taking a huge risk with the rabies.
Right.
Because people are going to be desperate for food. They're not going to be so picky about the food supply, you know, is it kosher or isn't it? You know, who cares?
Right.
The kids are starving.
Exactly.
We need to feed them. Nobody's going to run a rabies test on something that they caught, and they've got a bunch of kids that are starving to death. So it's going to get really scary out there. So do you think that we're, I know your site says it's not about if we are going to have this happen, but when? What do you see in the timing for this?
Yeah, I mean, that's a real problem. And that's, you know, that's one of the reasons that we really try to do our research so aggressively, because you're never, unfortunately, we're just not, at least so far, I'm not able to make an accurate prediction about when. So the way that I think about it is this. I live in Los Angeles. You ask any expert, and they say there will be a giant earthquake in Los Angeles, like devastating, massive earthquake that basically, you know, destroys all the power in the city and knocks the water out and does all that horrible stuff, right? They don't know when it's going to happen, but they say it's going to happen soon. The problem is you need to prepare as if it's going to happen tomorrow morning, because if you don't know exactly when it's going to happen, you need to find out as much as you can about it, and, you know, now I'm talking about zombies. We try to do as much research as we can, as quickly as we can, and seriously as we can, and we try to get prepared as well as we can right now, as if it's going to happen this instant, because you just never know. And once it happens, once a zombie shows up at your front door, there's no more time for research and conjecture and preparedness, right? There's no more time to get ready. When the zombies are around, it's run and scream time. It's, you know, it's grab your hat because things are about to get really hairy. So, you know, you got to get ready now, and that's really the key issue.
And the kind of zombies that we're looking at that are going to come are going to be something that kind of slips past everybody unnoticed. kind of like back in the day when dead animals would fall into the water supplies with rabies. And people would still use the water supply, not thinking, well, clear out the dead carcass. And the movie, what's it called, Dances with Wolves. Remember in the beginning, he finds the dead cow or whatever it is in the buffalo, and he's dragging out. And the Indians, for the life of them, can't understand what the heck he's doing, you know. He understood that the disease in the water made it not good to drink. This is going to kind of slip by where it's going to mutate and nobody's going to be paying attention. And do you think, let me just put you on the spot a little bit, do you think that it will be accidental or an intentional snafu?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. I think that I would probably lean towards like some sort of relatively accidental mutation, you know, something that. But I got to say that after speaking with some of the virologists that I have in the past couple of years, the fact that you could make one, no problem, you know, is really kind of scary. And there's one, you know, one thing you sort of touched on is the potential for mosquitoes to transmit this. For instance, if I'm infected and the incubation period is several days, if a mosquito bites me and then it bites you, you know, potentially it could be transferred that way. And then that makes me think of, you know, I don't know if you're familiar with this, but in 1955, the U.S. government dropped bombs on the state of Georgia, outside of Atlanta, filled with yellow fever mosquitoes, because they wanted to test the viability of using these mosquitoes as a biological weapon. So could you drop a bomb that doesn't explode onto a population, and then the bomb opens up, and then all these infected mosquitoes fly out? And what they discovered is, yeah, it's a completely viable thing to do. So, you know, if you could spread zombieism through mosquitoes, then that's definitely one biological method that seems pretty scary. You know, releasing a bunch of infected, you know, or carrier mosquitoes onto a population, you could spread zombieism all over a city and no one would even know it.
Brian, can you jot down ghost questions? Well, chemtrails. You know, you read about chemtrails constantly in conspiracy articles that they are releasing things to knock down the population because we can't support the population we have on Earth now. So a lot of people believe that that's exactly what chemtrails are. They're releasing something in the air, you know, that it's probably going to not take out a healthy person, but it might very possibly take out the very weak. You know, so, you know, chemtrails is another way, you know, let's say somebody screwed up the, whatever they're spreading around. Let's say they were going to spread around virus A, but somebody grabs the mad cow or the other one, the rabies, and that's what gets spread around because somebody didn't read the paperwork or didn't double check or triple check, you know. So you know, that has a lot of potential too. VX Llama has a question. How long theoretically do you think a zombie could go without eating, and you know, would they still be a threat even though they're not eating? See, a vampire, even though we know they don't exist and that they have to eat. That's the bottom line.
Right.
If they don't replace their dying blood supply, then they die. You know, they're
right.
You know, done. What about zombies?
Yeah, well, if we talk about the living zombie, you know, the zombie from Zombieland and the zombie from 28 Days Later, which I know, you know, 28 Days Later, a lot of people say is not a zombie movie, but, you know, broadly speaking, talking about a living infected person who's a maniac who's trying to attack you, that zombie would have the same rules and regulations of bodily function as any living person. So that zombie would need to eat. Now, you know, eating is much less of a necessity on a daily basis than drinking water is. So you're going to die of dehydration a lot quicker than you are to die of starvation. You know, it takes you could die of dehydration in 3 days, and you can die of starvation, so it's more like 3 weeks, you know? So roughly speaking. So So they're definitely going to need water, and they're going to need food. Now, if we talk about the undead zombie, the traditional Romero zombie, you know, this come back from the dead, and the heart's not beating, and the brain is operating it. The argument there is that they actually don't really need to eat. So they're driven by this compulsion, but theoretically, they're not required to eat and drink in the same way that humans do, and that's kind of a real advantage for them, you know, because meanwhile we're trying to survive. And we need to get regular infusions of water and food, and the zombies just keep going and going and going. Now, what does stop a zombie is that it is deteriorating. A zombie is a rotting corpse. So eventually it will just rot back into the earth so far that it can't even function anymore. But most theories are that that's not going to be impacted by how much it eats or doesn't eat. In fact, some theories suggest that if it eats, the more it eats, the worse off it is, because it's adding more flesh into its system that bacteria can grow in, and which will help it deteriorate quicker.
Okay, because VX Lama is making a point here, and she says, if a starving zombie's body started to use its own fat cells to live, then it would mutate the virus more. Well, viruses are always evolving. You know,
right.
So if you cut off their food supply, they evolve to make the best use of whatever it is that they need to keep going. Because a virus only reasoning is to keep going, you know, to multiply. That's the way viruses are. They don't sit
right.
there and think, I don't like this person, I'm going to make it sick. It's totally void of any conscious decision making. It's just, it's there, it's a predator, it's survival, its own survival, and in all species, no matter what it is, any life form, reproduction is
right.
the main show. That the whole thing is to just reproduce. That's, you know, they're kind of like horny old men, you know. Their whole, or horny young men, you know, their whole thing is just to keep going and going and make more horny people, you know. Viruses are kind of weird that way, you know. So I know it was an abstract, and I just shocked half the chat room. but you have to know me. But yeah, that's how I see it. So Ghost was saying, what was that about the question?
What constitutes a zombie over, say, a seriously infected person? That was one that Ghost had.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, if we're talking about the living zombie, right, like a like the zombie land, what constitutes a zombie is this lack of all personality and character. So the person that once occupied that body is essentially completely gone, right? So that's where the relentless aggression comes in. It literally is just an animal at that point, a relentlessly aggressive animal. So that's kind of where you get that. Now, if we're talking about the undead zombie, the much more, you know, classic traditional zombie, what really differentiates them is that they're dead, right? I mean, it's a walking corpse. So it's a corpse that stands back up and starts walking around. So that's a big difference from someone who's infected, you know? But yeah, the real notion of zombies, whether they're technically alive or undead or however you kind of, you know, different filmmakers want to characterize them, the biggest thing about a zombie is it has no personality, right? A zombie just does what it does, and it will continue to do it until it's no longer able to do it. So it has a single-minded focus. It doesn't care if you break its kneecaps or if you cut off its arm. It will continue to try to do what it wants to do, which is eat you. That's it. That's the only thing it wants to do. So that's kind of what characterizes a zombie, different than an infected person, because if I'm infected and really sick, who knows what the infection is, but I may get aggressive here or there. I may have different symptoms, but I'm still me, right? Ultimately, I'm still a person that has my same memories and has, you know, to a certain extent, my personality. But if I'm just purely a driven, you know, creature that's trying to eat other people, I've lost all sense of self. Does that make sense?
Yeah, in Walking Dead, the AMC thing that again, Andrew is my educator on all things zombies and really weird. But he brought the first season because, of course, I had not watched it, so I had no clue what he was talking about. But in it, there's the scene where the cop who woke up out of the coma and he sees the half a woman dragging herself along. And so he goes and he showers and does all kinds of things, cleans up, and he seeks her out, which she's still in the same field, dragging herself. And she says, I'm really sorry that this happened to you, and I don't know how it happened to you. And then he blows her brains out, you know, to put her out of her misery. You know, and that's the humanity part on his side. There is no humanity where she's concerned. She is just a creature, and she's only half a creature at that, but she's looking for something to eat.
Right.
And
even when she's on the ground, it's half. Even though she's almost totally decayed and she's half a person and she can hardly move, she's still reaching out to him because she wants to eat him. She's still reaching out, trying to get him because she wants to eat him, even though she's totally physically unable to do it.
Yeah.
And so that's sort of what defines a zombie, right? They're never going to say, ouch, I'm hurt, or, oh, look at me, oh, you know, I'm in a bad situation here. They literally just will keep trying to do what they want to do, no matter what.
Are you there? Yeah. We're going to go to break in like 4 minutes, but it's scary. Should people... Okay, when we come back, I want you to give us like a rundown of your Foreign Legion preparedness kit, what you would advise people to start moving and motivating themselves to be ready for this. I when I talk to people about animals, you know, pet care and stuff, I always tell them, you know, always have the carriers for your pets, you know, those carriers.
Right.
Have them ready. Have the blankets in them already. Have food, water, any medicines they take, any special things you need for them in an area where you're not running around saying, hey, where's Sparky's dish? Did anybody see Sparky's leash? You have to have a box with the animal supplies because of tornadoes. And here we're in New Jersey, hurricanes. When the last big hurricane, what was her name, Irene, whatever, I kept saying, please, people, make sure your animal crates are ready to be moved because the water is going to come in, and half New Jersey was just underwater, you know? And when we come back from the break, I want you to give the be prepared list, you know, what people should have ready for this, because while I don't think that we're going to have a situation where, you know, your aunt's dead on the mortician's table being prepared to be embalmed and suddenly her eyes open. Well, I have done that myself, but I wasn't dead. Yeah, I mean, I was dead, but I woke up. I didn't come back looking to eat people, you know. you know, there's a difference. You know, when I woke up, it was like, oh, crap, I'm back here again. But
only a partial zombie.
Yeah, only a partial. Yeah, but I don't think that's the big problem. I think it's more like what you're saying about we're all going to be sitting there one day, and one of our neighbors is going to be like, bang, bang, bang on the door, and you open up and say, hey, Ken, what's up? And he tries to bite you because he's like a mad dog, you know, with like some kind of rabies or something. That makes a lot more sense, and that's what's scary, because it does make sense that that could happen, and that something would take over a brain the way Alzheimer's does, you know, or any of those other diseases that attack, you know, there's no control mechanisms anymore. We're going to be right back with Matt Moke, and he's going to give us a survival, be prepared list of what to do to get yourself prepared before your neighbor knocks on your door saying, I'm here to eat your brains. And this is Game Con Radio. This is Mo Banshee's Lair. We're rocking your world. We'll be right back.
Whoever said size does not matter never heard of us. We give it to you long, sorry, hard and fast.
Game Con Radio, we rock your game.
This is Michelle Tomlinson, the Scream Queen, and I listen to Game Con Radio. Why? Because it rocks!
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We're going to talk about preparedness, getting your zombie infestation apocalypse preparedness kit ready. And as I've always said, you know, you should always have things ready for your pets because, you know, they didn't choose you, you chose them. Make sure you got crates ready for them with bedding, food, medicines. Know where their leash is. Have it all together so you're not running around the house looking for the dog's leash or the cat's special medicines and stuff like that. Have everything ready, but you should have that ready for your family. Now, if you think this is really a funny topic tonight and that it couldn't possibly happen, Center for Disease Control used a zombie invasion as a way to teach people about being prepared for catastrophic events. And they actually walk you through being ready for a zombie invasion. And I believe the reason they did it was to get something catchy that people would actually pay attention to and say, oh yeah, we should have you know, we should have hit the sound card, hit the mute button. I don't know what that means in the chat, because I'm not doing the tech stuff, Michael is. You know, I understand why they used it, because zombies are a hot topic right now. With all, you know, we go through these periods where it's UFOs, you know, big, and everybody wants UFO shows and movies and all. Then we went through the baloney with all the ghosts and everything, ghost hunters, lesbian Nazi ghost hunters, naked ghost hunters. You know, I mean, we've got it all. It's a circus. Now we're moving into zombies, and you've got AMC's Dawn Day of the Dead or whatever, and that kind of thing. So obviously the Center for Disease Control is using these kinds of things to talk to people because nobody listens to them, you know? But what, Matt, would a person want for a prepared kit?
Well, I mean, I think that it's good that you brought up the CDC article about that. And actually, they every year, they just to give you a little more info on that, every year the CDC puts out a preparedness bulletin in the same time about in May. I think it's about the beginning of tornado season, I think it's when they do it. And this year, normally they get about 1,000 hits on their blog over the whole year. Over a course of 1 year, only 1,000 people look at it. Well, they did zombies this year because they understood, and you know, this is something I very much agree with, the things you need to do to survive a zombie outbreak are the exact same things you need to do to survive any number of natural or man-made disasters. So they did it around zombies, and they got 25 million hits on their blog, and in just a matter of a day, and they crashed the government servers. It was on the cover of the New York Times, it was all over the place. So definitely zombies are hot, but I think that they did a really good job there, because they do have what's called a bug out bag. Anybody who's into survival, I'm sure, has heard of that. But, you know, it's your go bag or your last, you know, worst case scenario survival bag. That's the first thing I would say you definitely need. A lot of people call it a 72-hour kit, and the idea is that if you're caught in a disaster, a catastrophe, that you need to sort of be able to have enough food, water, shelter, security for 72 hours. And it also needs to be portable because potentially you'll have to leave your house, you know. So you can't just have, if you have, like for instance, if I have a pool in the backyard and they say, well, I got all the water in the world, I'm all set. Well, if somebody comes to my front door and they are armed enough or violent enough or whatever to force me to leave my house, all my water in that pool isn't doing me any good. So your survival kit needs to be portable. It's only as good as how well you can carry it. So mm-hmm. I would suggest getting a kit, you know, for zombies. I would suggest, you know, you need a kit for more than 72 hours. I would say a week or 2 weeks. But the problem is you really have to balance it against how well you can carry it, you know. So that's where, you know, ideally you'd want enough stuff for a whole year. But you're not going to be able to carry that on your back. So certain things that I really like are for food. I really like these ER bars. They're approved and used by the U.S. Coast Guard, and there's just, you know, there's a lot of different brands of them, but they're just these nutrition blocks. It just looks like a big block of nothing, you know, a sort of thick block of stuff, and it's got 3,800 calories in it, and it doesn't weigh very much to carry. It's pretty small. But 3,800 calories is a lot. Now, it doesn't taste great, but you don't have to cook it. You don't need to add water. You don't need to do anything. So that's great. That's why, in a lot of ways, it's better than some other versions of MREs that you might need to add water to or cook. You don't need to do any of this. Now, it's not going to taste good. It probably won't help your morale. It's not going to make you feel
Neither
good.
Neither does an MRE.
Yeah, right, exactly. But, you know, but it'll definitely keep you alive.
Some of those are good.
Like those. Yeah. I mean,
you
yeah,
haven't had to eat enough of them. You haven't had to eat enough.
That's for sure.
Okay, go ahead.
You know, the other thing, obviously, you need to really worry about is water. And unfortunately, you're never going to... The thought is that a human being, if you really want to be safe, you're going to need about a gallon of water a day. And unfortunately, water is kind of the last thing you want to skimp on because mm-hmm. the side effects of dehydration are really nasty and they can get bad really quick. So you're not going to be able to carry enough water. So you got to have, you know, some water. What I like to do is, and I actually did this for food, too, in a similar way. But for water at home, first of all, hot water heater is a great place to find water. If you have a traditional hot water heater, that stores an average of 50 to 75 gallons of water. So, you know, if you purify that with a little bleach, you're good. You got a lot of water. But, you know, obviously, if you have to get on the road, you're not going to be able to carry large amounts of water because, unfortunately, there's no way around the fact that it's heavy. So what you're going to want is water purification methods, you know, tablets or anything you can think of that would, you know, iodine pills, all sorts of stuff. I mean, there's tons of options if you just do a little research. But being able to purify water is definitely important. You don't want to escape the zombies or the other hostile humans only to die of some waterborne illness, you know, die of dehydration through extreme diarrhea because you drank dirty water, you know.
Right.
So, you know, that's really, really important. The next thing, and this really depends on, you know, your bag. What I always say is all survival is local, right? All zombie survival is local. So depending on where you are, then you need to adjust your bug out bag according to your clothing and shelter needs. I mean, like I said, I live in Southern California. So for me, I'm not going to need extreme cold weather clothing, right?
Right.
But one thing it is going to be a big concern for me is Los Angeles is essentially a desert. And we have the LA River, but we don't get our water from the LA River. The LA River is just a little trickle of nothing. We get all our water pumped in from 400 miles north over, something like 2,500 feet of mountain. It goes up 2,500 feet. It comes back down 2,500 feet. So if that's ever cut off, all of Los Angeles, 12 million people, are going to be completely without water almost instantly. And, you know, we live on an ocean, but, you know, you got to remember ocean salt water, right? So that does you no good. So my real concern in L.A. is about the water, where to find water, how to purify water. But if you live in a colder climate and there's some place that has more available water, you're really going to want to worry about your clothing and shelter and things like that. And then, of course, with zombies, there's always the concern about weapons, you know, and the question of what is the best zombie weapon and, you know, all of that stuff.
And we were discussing that, the machete, a whack knife, something that gives you a bit of distance to keep it from biting, but it's silent, too. You don't want something that's going to ring the dinner bell for everybody else.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah. When we say local, know your surroundings. And it's like you're living in Tornado Alley. Have an understanding of the building around you. If part of it collapses, where would you escape? It's the same thing for a fire. Knowing how, having an escape route that, you know, you can get to, you know. So if they come in the front door, you've got a way out. But this is all stuff people don't think of until the intruder enters the house. And then they're right. Like, oh, my God, you know, because in this day and age, and I see a lot of this, houses, there are people that never open their windows because they have central air. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
So a lot of windows don't even open, even though by law you have to have windows that can open so you can get out of them. A lot of houses, I just saw one the other day, the entire front of it, none of the front windows open. They're all like decorative windows and stuff. You have to have all of this in your head before. How are you going to get out? Because, I mean, once the fire hits, once the whatever the intruder is in, then you're looking around and it doesn't even occur to you to take a chair and break the window so you can get out, you know. These are all things that people really need. And these are survival skills. I swear, you know, I think that more people should watch survival shows, not because I think it's cool to watch these morons eating bugs and disgusting stuff, but it makes you
entertaining.
Yeah, it makes you think about, okay, now a guy just came in my front door and there's just this window that doesn't open. Now, how do I get out of here? Well, you take something and put it through the goddamn window. What's the matter with you?
Yep.
You know?
Yep.
But people,
you get
in
out.
Their heads, in their heads, they go, well, that window doesn't open. You know? And you know, now they're victims. Again, tell them where you're going to be signing books and lecturing.
I'm signing books at this Thursday. This is coming a couple days from now at New York University Bookstore, which is in Lower Manhattan, at 6 p.m. on, like I said, this coming Thursday. And then I'm going to be at on the weekend of the 21st and 22nd. I think I'm going to be in Detroit and Chicago. Then I'm going to be lecturing all throughout the month, all over the place. So I go to Northern Arizona University, University of New Mexico. A couple school in Alabama, school in Tennessee, Virginia, kind of all over the place. Pennsylvania, I'm going to Indiana University, Pennsylvania. So if you just check my website, or if you go to the main website, you can click through onto my website, mattmoke.com, and you'll see the whole schedule there. But I'm going to be all over the place.
Yeah, and the regular site is www.zombieresearch.org.
Yep.
And Matt has said he will come back and visit us again, especially if he writes something new or anything new is coming out that we should be aware of. I want to thank you so much for coming on. This was really interesting and not a little bit scary if you really start to think about this. I mean, paranoid people are going to be like arming themselves God help them if the neighbor wakes, you know, bangs on the door with a hangover, you know, they're dead meat, you know. But this is really, this was really an incredible show, and I am so honored that you came on. Anything you wanted to add before I cut you loose?
And I don't think so. I had a great time. I really appreciate you having me on.
Thanks so much for coming out. Back.
Yeah, it was great. It was a lot of fun.
It was a lot of fun. And don't let the zombies get you, okay?
Exactly. Stay safe.
Okay. Yeah. All you got to do is hang up, and I'll email you when the show is up on podcast. You can download it. You can use it anywhere you want to use it, okay?
Great. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Night-night.
Bye-bye.
That was really, really interesting. That was very interesting. I mean, just thinking about what the potential is for this to mutate into an airborne disease is really frightening when you look at super flus and things like that. I mean, it's really, really scary when you think about what can happen. And it's, you know, we're not talking about necessarily dead people getting up like in Night of the Living Dead. The guy's been dead. He's in a grave and he beats his way out of a coffin. We're talking about people getting sick, not realizing what it is. And then they just start violently lashing out. And, well, like that crackhead that attacked the women with the baby. I mean, that to me was scary, you know, because and here's another thing about being prepared. Even back in 1970, I'm a young mother, and you've got the baby prams and strollers and all, and not all of them came with the little belts. So what I would do was get those little like rope belts that they would have, and make belts out of them, and I would leash the baby in there so that they didn't topple out, you know, like moving around. But nowadays, you got to make sure your baby is securely in there so somebody can't just walk up and grab the baby out of it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's scary, scary stuff when you come to think of it. This has been a great kickoff. I'm hearing myself. Somebody's got a speaker going and it's feeding back.
Sounds good on this end.
You know what? Well, I'm hearing it, and it just showed up. It just showed up. It's quiet now. But this has been a great kickoff for Halloween month for us. And I mean, this has just been great. Next week is going to be a psychic, Cheryl Lynn. I met her down a couple of a month or so ago. And Sherilyn is what you would call a natural born psychic, from a child picking up on things. And she's going to come, and she will be taking callers. So people can call in and they can, you know, ask her questions and stuff like that. And she will be doing predictions for 2012. So that's really cool. Then October 18th, we're going to have Salem Witch Museum. They're going to come on. We're going to be talking about 1692, what went on, the witch trials, and what's going on in Salem now. One of our members is directly related to Bridget Bishop, one of our members at Asylum. So, it's kind of... you know, wow, what a legacy to have for your family that she was hung twice. She was tried on June 2nd and hung on June 10th, Bridget Bishop, you know, crazy. October 25th, Catherine Ramsland, criminal justice, clinical psychology, forensic psychology. She's going to come on, and we're going to talk about real vampires. Again, none of the make-believe stuff. She is going to come on and talk about the possibility of real vampires in society, what they are. Then November 1st, Captain Rick Yoakum of New Jersey SPCA is coming on, and he's going to talk about, you know, what we can do, you know, about reporting things that we see. A lot of people will not report something. You know, they'll see something going on with an animal, And I hear this all the time. I feel so bad. There's this dog. Every time I go past the house, the dog is tethered to a tree, and, you know, its bowl is full of ice, and there's no water out for it. And when I sit there and say to him, why aren't you calling the police or the animal control? I don't want to get involved. Well, then don't tell me about it. What do you think I'm going to do? You know, I don't even know where you are. You know, people, especially in now times, people are struggling. They can't feed their kids. So they look at Fido and say, guess what? Your history. They just dump them out. And this is going down the camper. One of my neighbors down the campground said to me, you know, there's a bunch of new cats down here. That's because people are bringing their cats there and dumping them because they don't want to take care of them. Oh, isn't that a cute kitty? Yeah, you can have it. Well, now it's fall. We're closing the camper. Goodbye. No, the kitty lives down there now. What, you know, I want to take these people and I want to punch the living hell out of them, which might make me a zombie. I'm not sure. But animals require...
Just don't eat their brains. Be all right.
Yeah, yeah. Animals require shelter. They require food. They require water. And if you're not willing to spend any time with them, being a good owner and petting them and talking to them, you shouldn't have an animal. You know, please, people, stop taking animals that you don't want just because it looks good or you think it's going to catch some girls for you or some guys for you or make old people, these old men, go to the dog parks and they got the dog there. The dog is fatter than all get out and it's barely able to walk and they're hoping they're going to meet some chick there. You know, they use it like a chick magnet, you know. Animals are not made of rubber. Animals need care. They need...
And chicks love a fat dog.
Yeah, you know, do me a favor. If you know of an animal that's in trouble, report them. You can tell them. Nobody's going to go up, knock on the door and say, oh, by the way, Mo said that you're abusing your animal. Dog fighting. You know, they take small dogs and they steal them and they use them to teach the other dogs how to kill. And cats. They use kittens and cats to teach them how to kill. So people, dog fighting is not a good thing. To me, if you've got animals and you're doing this, I don't even want you near my grandchildren because I got a hunch you're going to throw them in the cage one day too. All people who abuse animals like this should be shot. Do the world a favor and just kill them all. If you're going to fight dogs, if you're going to fight animals, even roosters, if you're going to fight animals, get up, man up, and you go fight to the death against another human being. That's why I love that show, Beat Down Bully or whatever it's called. I love that show. But please, animals need care. And we're working out with Dr. Joseph Resnick about him coming on in November, and this guy, big NASA water filtration. You know those tubes that they used in for the oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico and stuff. This guy created all that stuff. I mean, this guy is a genius, you know. So he's going to be coming on in November. And again, I want to thank our guest tonight, Matt Moke, who was on zombieresearch.org. He's got a book, a couple of books out. Let me bring them up while I've got a few minutes to kill. Everything you ever wanted to know about zombies and the zombie autopsy secret notebooks from the apocalypse, that's on their site. That's Not Your Mommy Anymore. It's a children's book warning children. If mommy starts looking like she's going to eat you, start worrying. And, you know, like I said, there's a lot of people on drugs right now. And I think VX might be able to back me up on this. They shouldn't have their children with them anymore. But they're as close to a zombie as you want to get. They're mindless creatures that should just be put down because what they're doing to their children is just unbelievable. But that's me, and that's why nobody's going to let me be any kind of cop or anything because I'd be in jail for murder or something, you know, if I walked into a situation like that. So anyway, this is what's going on in the asylum. We do have that. I gave you the word for this week, and I'm not allowed to repeat it again. The music tonight was If I Had a Gun by Dead Milkmen, Something Ain't Right by David Byrne, and Wave of Mutilation by the Pixies. We have a contest going on, and the word, I can't give it to you again, but there's a drawing, and Anthony is the guy you got to get a hold of on asylumsgate.com. It's a free registration. The Mammoth Book of Cover-Ups, 100 Most Disturbing Conspiracies of All Time. You get the word, the magic word, when I say the word you need is, and you get a hold of him there and let him know the word, and he'll put you in the drawing. And I think at the end of November, he's planning on having one of the kiddies pull the name out of the winner. So that's what we're doing. There's another word you need in the newsletter. I'm sorry, there's a newsletter. You can get access to that on the site too, asylumsgate.com. And you get the other word there. So if you go to asylumsgate.com, Spooky UK will have everything posted so you understand exactly what you're supposed to get so you can be entered in the drawing. And with that, do you have any zombies living by you there, Brian?
Oh, there may be a few here and there, but we've pretty much got them weeded out of the neighborhood now, I think.
Yeah, calling the cops on them and having the cops there all the time tends to move them out, you know?
Yeah, they got them down at a lockup downtown, so I think we're okay for now.
I want to thank everybody for listening in tonight. I want to thank GameCon Radio for hosting our show. And I want to wish everybody a very good night. And we'll be back next week with Psychic Sherilyn. Be ready to call in your questions and listen to what we can expect for 2012. I can tell you one thing. The calendar, people already have them out because I have a 2012 calendar already. So I think it's going to happen no matter what happens. The thing is, will zombies spoil anything? So everybody have a good night. God bless you all. I love you all. Good night.
Good night.
For visiting me at my lair. Mo Banshee's Lair is carried live Tuesday evenings at GameConRadio.com. Recorded shows can be heard at MoBanshee'sLair.podomatic.com. If you wish to contact me, you can find me on the team page at AsylumCam.com. Have a very cool week, and God bless you and yours.